What is it that crumbles beneath our feet, and why should we care? What is eternal, and what is transitory? And must we make the old story strong, lest the world loses heart? Confused prayers and odd longings drifted amongst drifting clouds, and it dawned on Marlowe that when Stravinsky's Rite of Spring was first performed in Paris 100 years ago, the land he was standing on now was the high hunting ground of another tribe long gone. That tribe, too, would have had a ritual for the adoration of the earth, some sacrificial dance. He could intuit it all around him. The erotic subtext was palpable, nature renewing and breaking through mud. The smell, primitive and dank. It's a messy business coaxing order out of disorder. It begins with the feet, the earth energy rising up through the feet. Sometimes it took days for him to feel the earth was alive, but suddenly all would animate. Mad as a hatter and primed for transcendence, Marlowe watched red moths flutter in purple-flowered bushes. Bing, bang, boom, he could feel the beat of his wild heart. Out on the wild edge, head cocked, waiting to hear the first notes of the witching tune. It was a day in May, alone in the garden on top of a hill. Happiness was available. Marlowe didn't rush the melody of the goat man. He knew, after slow, soaking silence, the opening refrain would sail down on silver shafts and explode. Pow! The party was on. Let the ballet begin. Yeah, who knew better how to pluck and peel a purple grape clean than the godly old goat? And he was Mr. Handy Dandy with a chainsaw. With him would be satyrs, happy to graze on the lawn, their goat feet primed to dance an antic hay. Characters all, and all with stories, and not all glory, not all pretty pretty. And maybe it was best they left their stories at the door. On their arms would be their wives, crones with rattled tongues, clucking about misdeeds and old hurts, unhinged women once known for their beauty, the type artists have always preferred. And at the witching hour, they would all be laughing and all be beautiful again. Flowers pink, yellow, white, gold, and blue would flutter and swivel when up from the river, soft, soft, no sound of footfall, rosy-cheeked maidens would make their way single file on swift feet, the town Lotharios trailing close behind. Soon, the garden would ooze with original sin. For Marlowe, the transformation came in waves and pockets. It took a special vibration for the invisible to become visible, like the sound of beating wings. And Marlowe was startled by a yellow warbler shooting past like a tongue of flame to announce the arrival of the king. All eyes feasted when the gruff godly goat appeared in his kingly disarray. So much in a ruin to admire, tattered and triumphant, and silkily rough-hewn. He mumbled inarticulately while his arms beat the air to stir the wind, to move the limbs, to make the dance. There was a beating of sticks, a violent and grimly modern sound, the vernacular of the epoch. The dance started in a circle. It ended in a circle. Inside the mystic circle, many circles. All minds melded into one mind. All hearts beat as one heart. An austere rite consecrated by time. The choreography was simple. All moved as a unit, except for the sacrificial beauty. A dagger of light pierced through a cloud break to illuminate the goat man as he raised his baton, and on the downbeat, swack, swack, the echo of music. But not music, something else, a rhythm, a beat, an insistent pulse, oh bop de bop de bop, oh yeah. Let the day unfurl. This is a primal dance, lest we forget. But this goat wanted more merriment and less sorrow. Less perfection, less ambition, more amusement, less angst. He wanted to roll and wallow in warm earth and get dirt caked on his lips and under his nails. Feel his feet on warm stone. Debonair, time-worn hypnotizer with a honey tongue and always a ladies' man. Marlowe heard the goat whisper to his prima ballerina, "Call me at midnight. I'll meet you at the side door. We'll climb the secret stairs." "Fine," she said. "Just remember, I could read when I was 3. The old goat gave pleasure. Pleasure was his secret. He was the sort who could croon under a window, a lily in his left hand and a rose in his right, and make the women ache at the thought that his first craven kiss might be the last. "Oh," he would swoon, "your eyes are pools of love. Let me splash in those pools." Always ready with an elegant tune in a minor key, the mischievous scoundrel would tell anyone who would listen that he was on the A train with Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn. And it was he who nicknamed Billy Sweet Pea. "Ah," he would laugh, "if we were even more than half divine, would a day like this be any better?" Yes, it was a day in spring, a day so springy-dingy that the force of the green fuse that drove the flower also drove his not-so-green age. Another spring, another year older, a little worse for wear, or maybe a lot. Winter had left the garden rough, rotting wood and weeds, rocks had tumbled off of walls, fences were in want of fortification, fallen leaves were everywhere. A seemingly futile task to make right. But the sparrows were frisky. Marlowe caught his reflection in a mirror. The mirror mocked him as he did a jig. The man in the mirror was frayed, torn, badly worn, ragged, jagged. "Go ahead, look. Dance." And Marlowe danced, and his reflection danced. And one became the other, the man, the goat, the man, the god. 39 times the same chord. And as the orchestration turned discordant, the goat's thoughts turned indecorous. "Ah, there," said the goat, recounting clandestine couplings in these very woods. 2 a.m. trysts and bad choices. Only lightly regretted. Yes, and there, there, and there. Thus it was every spring. And every spring Marlowe worried he wouldn't have the juice. Every year he had to dig deeper and listen for a clear voice to clarify who he truly was at the core. He knew he was not a Chandler Marlowe, or a Conrad Marlowe, or even a Kit Marlowe, brazen libertine, fornicator, debaucher of innocence. Not far from the mark, but Marlowe resonated to the groove of some more distant antiquity. He'd recently dreamed he'd entered a strange temple, where mystifying calligraphy adorned crack sanctuary walls, along with birds painted with yellow dot eyes surrounded by red and white circles. And at the same time, Marlowe knew this was his temple, where he belonged. There was no ceiling above only moon. As a parade of musicians, 2x2, men and women, barefooted on a dirt floor and in joyous costumes, bent and sashayed with serpentine twists while playing an alien tune on eccentric flutes that penetrated him deeply. The first flute hit a high note. It was matched by a note even higher, and then an even higher note. And to answer that, a note impossibly higher. That was the one. and to himself in his dream he said, I miss this. This I miss. Poets, once doers, were now at best sayers, increasingly unheard. Still, Marlowe's duty was to bear witness. The past gone, the future not what it used to be. Still, a happy man desires a happy God. A happy God is a groovy God, with groovy hooves and a groovy tail. And so it was with the great god Pan, a sage for the age. Meanwhile, the frenzied, jet-lagged Russian composer was berating the hapless choreographer. Don't reiterate the dance. Dance against the music. We are dancing ourselves to death to be reborn. On stage, dusting off the muck, a crooked smile promising splendid resurgence. The old goat pointed to a vague spot in a doubtful heaven. You, he teased, surely you remember how it was crawling out of the crib, rolling off the boulders. Every winter took its bite, and in these days of spring, Marlowe took an accounting, made note of the deferred maintenance, the neglect, the pilfered priorities, the creeping sloth, the poison oak, the decade-old junk veiled by overgrown bushes, the scrap metal and wire fencing hiding in the undergrowth. Everything goes to rack ruin beneath the thud of years. And how do we even remember our sins? It had been hot and bone dry, and Marlowe worried about fire. The dead wood had to go, and the invasive French broom, and the prickly purple thistle. Marlowe felt eyes watching him, faces in the cactus. And then he was dwarfed by the tall stalk and white bloom of the century plant, looking like an omniscient prophet catapulted skyward. And Marlowe wanted to live forever, but we do not live forever. And so what if the king's raiment is ripped and his empire stripped? And why should we not die as the beast dies? Why give a damn about tomorrow? Perfection is right here, right now. And Marlowe knew when the blossoms blossomed, it was time for him to blossom. The question? How to tell this story. In the garden, he waited for a concept so simple and obvious, clever and compelling, that it would drop off his pen and sizzle with a hot splash. If such a line existed, was he the man to write such a line, or should it be best left to the goat? If the task did fall to him, could he tell the truth about himself in plain words? It takes energy to renew. He could feel the charged vibration of the string section, and he was seduced by a solo flute before the insistent brass. One danced for oneself, one danced for the tribe, one danced for the red-tailed hawks and the red-shouldered hawks and the turkey vultures surfing the current. For the elders, it was all mojo. How he admired those wizened mandarins with their beautiful manners, their speaking fingers, those narratives in gesture, always ready with a bon mot or merry conceit. Colors flashed up and down their chakras, voltage cranked, steam shimmered off balding heads and blended in textured harmonies as a pair of matched monarchs, yellow and black, gave chase through the oaks. Let the ceremony commence. Let the eye look into the heart. And Marlowe began to spin. He spread out his arms. He whirled. He twirled. He attuned. Grayish blue. Everything restless. A muted horn announced that the entire cast and crew would be drunk before the sunset. In the nether gloom, they would all feel the dew-green cool and be cavorting shamelessly. Yes, dance. Dance. Yes. Yes. A twittering red bird came to rest in the hollow corner of the hill. Above, two streaks of white. And in the center of the cloud, what looked like a fish, with a head and a tail. Marlowe had always been a South Seas man, and he remembered a sunset on a tropical island. Out on the reef, he knew fish were circling each other, that dance fish do, round and round. There would be flying fish, and over the water miles from land, a blue butterfly. And on the shore, a white reef heron, hopping from stone to stone. And it was as if he and the bird shared a common soul. Or as if he were looking at his own soul outside of himself. And he called to the bird. But the bird flew off. This day was not as warm as that. And Marlowe was far from the tropics. He heard coo, 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 coo. A brownish bird with a golden underside, as if to ask, is there something new to say, to think, to do? Marlowe believed the answer was always yes, and he was always willing to be hurled into a mass of divergent impressions. But first, so much psychic debris to burn off, including last night's nightmares. A bird pierced with a fish hook. Terrorist shooting at him inside a closed car. Marauding Chinese in the public square, trampling him underfoot. And after he was interrogated by a young girl from the Ministry of Propaganda, he encountered a crow covered in string. He unwound the string, and the crow moved on. Marlowe heard flies buzzing around rotting meat, and there she was, the propaganda girl, pulling him from the rampaging mob, her uniform crisp, her blue buttons bright, and he heard clang, 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 as menacing puppet shadows flattened on high city walls. Then the words, do we even know our sins? There was a shudder in the air. The vortex was iridescent. If he poked his finger at it, he could permeate the membrane, one dimension into another. His world was a floating, shimmering bubble. And if his bubble burst, there would be a price to pay. But Marlowe had been up and down on the merry-go-round, and when he heard the hurly-swirly sound, he danced the whirly-twirly dance. And he was dancing faster now, and with ever more fury. He knew flirting with madness could be dangerous business, but all was whirling light, all was intoxicating movement and kaleidoscopic patterns. Is this what Busby Berkeley was projecting on his windshield as he drove through the night? Arms and torsos, a scooting camera flying between legs, alcohol on his breath as he swerved his car into the oncoming lane on the Roosevelt Highway. Can we even fathom our sins? Marlowe's transgressions were not so weighty, and all would be forgiven of him on a day like this. At least he forgave himself. Marlowe was generous in this way. He knew how terribly things could go wrong in a split second. All the same, his was the muse of mischief, the muse of fun, the muse of euphoria. But what was the story, and what was the glory? The precise words are not always the perfect words, and Marlowe's myth was strictly a low-budget affair. Still, he'd need a headline, big type, simple, elegant, but with a punch. The Goat Man Cometh. kettle drums, plucking strings, raucous horns to praise the rascals, the rebels, the rabble-rousers, the twisters of the plot, the stirrers of the pot. For a thunderous entrance, metal sheeting was shaken, and out he stepped. Stubble on his chin, weathered hat, ironic garment. Not a clown, not a fool, just the man who gleamed the pool. His long pole made crooked by the pool's reflection. At the deep end, Marlowe saw bubbles rising. A mermaid, her Medusa hair like soft twisting coral, her lustrous skin shiny and silvery, her glassy scales like some translucent brocade of sea-green silk. Later that night, when the moon was blurry, she'd wiggle her tail for the boys at the bar. And Marlowe made a note to buy some algicide and chuckled about the man who came to fix his pool pump, who had played at this house when he was little. They were swingers, the people who lived here before. We kids would hide and gawk in the windows until the mother of my friend saw us. Then she'd pile us in the car and drive us to the top of the hill and make us walk back, which would take a couple of hours, and by that time, the fun was over. Marlowe peered in the canyon and thought about what was lost. 2 years earlier, he had watched the fire that had burned Big Sur and could still smell the smoke dense with ash. There was sadness. There were ghosts. And only the garden's throbbing pulse protected him from feeling diminished. Where did he end? Where did others begin? Even we, even so, easy come, easy go. Hummingbirds hovered amongst the hydrangeas. Bees and butterflies did their business. Ding, 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 ding. Each sultry flower a celluloid star. No dinkies, no bit players, no superfluous extras. Step right up, pink young things. Keep the line moving. So many to tempt, too many to remember their names. Splendor without end, and his job was to administer soft, seductive kisses. The flowers vamped, and he returned the compliment with lively steps. In the garden was always the lover, and Marlowe thought of what was past or passing or to come. It was all there, high thoughts and lofty sounds, an ode to sky and woods. Was the wind blowing, or were the leaves frolicking on their own? It was a work day. There was work to be done. A day alone, and it seemed his garden was already crowded. Marlowe desired a garland of daffodils, a crown of twigs, and a beard of daisies and buttercups, and if he could, he would pollinate all his sweet darlings, so fine, so sleek. With a melodious whoop, he'd wield his wingdinger of a stinger, and all would sway to the low-down sound of his reed song. Yeah, baby, no water murmurs but what my fine flute pours. Oh, holy jester, holy satyr, holy man, so amorous, so dangerous, so glamorous, haughty, naughty, and something about the regal goat still in the midmost of youth. Ha! Marlowe was ready to squander it all, ready to pay whatever it cost on songs and gaiety. On a day like this, spirits can be seen in a certain light. They are said to be recluses who practice alchemy, but everyone was welcome to speak to them. But why talk at all when there is no bottom to the silent depths of the heart? A day in spring, a blue and fragrant breezy noon, and we must be our own disciple. In the life surreal, perhaps the dream is the real you. In this dream, we seek the other, the lover. Oh, how we would laugh, how we would roar, and in spite of snares and bad omens in the lower city, we would cross the dream bridge, you on my arm, like an exiled goddess, two small people half naked and trembling. May our love last 10,000 years, and may our dust mingle together forever. What do mirrors do when we are not there? We think nothing, but perhaps they alone see impish spirits playing their secret games as rustic worshippers stomp the ground while our alleged virgin dances herself silly. Don't worry. She'll be back next year. Or her sister. Go ahead. Be a flower for half an hour. Backstage was chaos. The rotund impresario shouted that this wasn't what he had in mind, not at all. This was a travesty. Then he calmed down and was heard cooing to the chorus that he intended to pray more, just as soon as he could hire someone to do his praying. A jar of hot lightning passed from lips to lips as maidens, some in and some out of costume, flittered about while gray goats and fresh bucks alike leered, their faces red. Inaudible harps were drowned out by brass and strings. No quiet corner. Every year it starts this way. Marlowe thought about his life beyond his garden. Another larger level of disarray. He'd settled into failure. He'd settled into what was left. None of his grand ambitions had come to fruition. But even if they had, what difference would it make? Embrace, he told himself. Embrace this crowded moment. Embrace the cloud wrangler kite high in the crazy blue, juggling circus balls, now silver, now gold. Embrace the fairies and sprites and pink buds floating on the water. His garden was offering softness. Softness in which to sink. All around him danced his lovers, and he danced with them. Their souls were one soul, ever expanding. Dance, embrace. Oh, come here. Just one more do-si-do around the pool. Ezra Pound wrote, "If any man would be a lover, he may walk on the Scythian coast. No barbarian would go to the extent to do him harm. The moon will carry his candle, and the stars will point out the stumbles. Cupid will carry lighted torches before him and keep mad dogs off his ankles. Thus, all roads are perfectly safe at any hour." Ah, yes. That's how it was when the goat man cometh. Ba-boom, ba-boom, ba-boom. Marlowe believed in the rhythm that came up through his feet. That crazy rhythm that never let him down. Ba-boom, 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 ba-boom. Marlowe tossed a pocket full of wildflower seeds on the hillside. On the road below, a radio blasted from a passing car, teenagers searching for the swimming hole. In the sky, a band of blue was separated by a band of rose pink. Pa, pa, pa. A bird Marlowe could not see. Maybe a messenger from the ancient temple to say, "Disdain not wild disorder. Disdain not the broken pots. Disdain not the mess. Disdain not sins scattered everywhere. Let the resurrection begin. Dance, it does not matter that you are no Nijinsky."